So during this talk, so I'll be talking about building enterprise apps using WSO2 platform. So if you are already familiar with the WSO2, some of the WSO2 products, then you might have some understanding on where you can use it. And if you are totally new to the WSO2 platform, then you will you'll be able to have some understanding by the end of this talk on where you can use the products for which purposes. Right. So I'll be first talking a little bit about enterprise applications in a very short manner, and their features and requirements, and then I'll jump into the leveraging WSO2 platform on building the enterprise applications. So if we talk about the, when I looked at the definition of an enterprise application, so it says it's a big application, and it's a business application, and by nature, they are complex, scalable, distributed, component-based, and mission-critical. So this definition I got from MSDN, Microsoft site. So the features, so obviously they are complex. Yes, you can start with a very simple enterprise application, but by the time it will grow and become a very complex one, because you keep adding new features and you have new business requirements coming and you want to reach more audience. So with all those things, it will become very complex. Why it is complex? So I think the next four steps explain why they are complex. The next four points. So they are component based, which means like so earlier days, like about maybe 15, 20 years ago, we had these monolithic applications. Yes, everything was done in the same app. So it was sitting at single place and doing whatever you wanted. But when things evolved with these different architecture patterns and different technologies like web, SOA, RESTful services, and all those things, then things started becoming component-based. So there are different components to do different stuff, for example, to handle the databases, to handle the APIs, to handle the other services, and authentication, authorization. So we have different components. And by nature, they are these are distributed. So you have your, let's say, the API store at one place and the backend sitting at another place. Then you have the authorization server at another place. So these communicate using the network. So the network plays a major role. And there's so distributed computing. There's high chance of failure. So you need to think about those things. So then things become more complex, etc., etc. So these are mission critical. For example, if you take an enterprise application which is developed in, let's say, eBay or StubHub, so they are very critical, right? So if they fail for 1 minute, they lose a huge amount of money. Huge number of transactions are lost. And let you know, if StubHub APIs goes down for a couple of minutes, we know how many ticketing purchasings are affected. And then this has to be scalable. So we know we can start small, but when things become popular, when things expanded, we need to, as a business, we need to have our enterprise applications in a scalable manner. So you can't put them in a single box and expect that everything to go well. So you need to plan for the spikes and the seasonal loads and all those things. So when we design an enterprise application, there are requirements. So the first thing is the business goals. So for example, if an enterprise is thinking of developing or building this new application, so you will get a lot of requirements from you know, the big stakeholders at the top level, the C-level stakeholders. So and the marketing guys, sales guys, so they'll pump all these requirements. And another critical thing is the time to market, and so how soon it has to be delivered. Because whenever the most of the times these requirements come, like they come with very tight deadlines, and the budget. So although they want a silver bullet, they don't have the budget for that silver bullet. So you have to get things done in a very cost-effective manner. And the staff. So if you don't have internal IT staff, then you have to think about how many people you will need to develop it, to test it. Then most importantly, after deploying, you have to maintain it, because like these are mission critical stuff. Then the concurrency it has to support, and the hardware. So if you're hosting it by your own, you have to consider about the hardware where you are going to deploy, the security of that, those things. And also, you are not alone in your enterprise. So you have been having some practices from like maybe 5 or 10 years, 5 or 10 years, where you have some applications which you are used to. So those might be legacy applications, and you might have these SAP systems, ERPs, other content management systems, and all those things where you can't get rid of, and you have to live with them, but still you need to improve. So it's a challenge that you have to evolve with some of these legacy apps in your backyard. And they need to be reliable, because you know that if these are distributed, then things can go wrong, and if some part fails, everything other has to function without noticing that failure. So they have to be reliable. And once you have the application, you need to have a better understanding on what's happening. You don't know whether things are going okay in your enterprise, like if there's the trends, what are the trends, what are your how are the KPIs working, and if things are failing, how often they fail, and why they are failing, where they are failing. And you want to check, if for example, if you take an e-commerce application or an online shopping application, okay, why users are not buying stuff, why they just surf and go away. So you have to have analytics to understand those things. So these are the requirements. Now I'll talk about how you can leverage the WSO2 platform on achieving about requirements and building your enterprise application. So I'll start. I'll take you through this journey from bottom up, right? So I'll start with building your services. If you don't have any services, and if you are thinking of going to a service-oriented architecture, then you need to have some services defined with proper contracts and all those things. And this can be like, so if you don't have anything, you'll have to build services, then it's somewhat easy. But if you have existing stuff, then you have to expose them properly and let the others know that these are my interfaces to my enterprise. So I have something which my enterprise is supposed to do, and these services are the interface for them. So those are about the services which you have and you might develop. And also there's another aspect, that is you have data and you want to expose them as services. So data as a services is also an interesting thing, because for an enterprise, the data is the most valuable asset you have. You can do wonders with your data. You can either become successful or you can go down because of data. And then the later stuff, such as microservices. So now I think you might have heard about the word microservices during this conference as multiple times. So it's the hype these days. So sometimes when you start designing these applications, you know, you might think, okay, it's better to have microservices involved, but that's not the case. Just because it's a hype, it shouldn't be used. But the thing is, those days we were okay to wait about 30 seconds for our servers to start, but being human beings and being very ambitious guys, now we can't stay 30 seconds. Now we want them to start in 2 seconds and serve our request within milliseconds, and so that's our expectation. So that's why sometimes we need these microservices. So you might need microservices, you might not, depending on the business and the nature of your requirements. So for that, I have the bottom layer defined. So you can use the application server to, if you have any existing services, you can host them in application server. And if you have the data which you want to expose as a service, then you have the data services server. So during most of these the integration scenarios, I have seen the data services server playing a very interesting role in exposing the data, because like it's not only about like exposing the data as a service, but you can have these the features such as what you call combining data from multiple databases, multiple tables, and transactional behaviors. So all those features are there. And then the latest addition to the family, the microservices framework. So in the next talk, Samira will take you through the microservices framework. So then you will get some more idea how you can use it in your architecture. So we have the service layer defined now. If you I said that you might have existing services, you might need new services, or you might not need any of them at all, but you might only have some existing systems running, like a SAP system, an ERP, a legacy, financial system, which you want to like. So you have this legacy financial system, but you want to present it to your customers in a very, very millennial manner with a lot of cool features like, social login and all those things. When you talk about integration, the challenges are these systems, they talk like different protocols, different formats, and so we have to cater such things. And then we might need, depending on some of the use cases, we might need this reliable delivery and pub sub pattern. And then we might need to like use multiple services and orchestrate them and get a result out of that one. So those kind of scenarios can occur. And sometimes, although you expose certain requirements, you might need to have some control to you by having some approval mechanisms like human control. For example, let's say you expose your APIs in the API store, but you don't want everyone to sign up and use them. So you want to control that. So you need to have some approval mechanism. So those kind of requests can arise. So for the integration scenario, we have, so one thing I forgot to tell that WSO2 has about 25 products, maybe 26. But I'm not going to cover everything in this session, but I'll be picking some of the major products and I'll be including them in this architecture. So for these major integration scenarios, so one of the favorite choices are the enterprise service bus. So you can integrate almost any system using that one. You can do protocol, you can combine two systems which use different protocols, different message formats. You can transform the messages and those kind of things. And if you want reliable delivery, you can incorporate a message broker in the middle and put your messages there and let the ESB retrieve them and do the work. And like if things fail, put it back to the queue so you have the reliability there. And then for orchestration and human, the things like the approval stuff, the human task nature, you can use the business process server. So you can combine multiple services and do service orchestration, and also it has the human task features with it. And it has this BPM and support as well. So so after having this integration stuff sorted out, now you are exposing the internal stuff to the outside, then you need to think about security. So let's say you have opened up the financial software, the legacy software, through some services to the outside. Now you add some risk because you need to secure it. So when it comes to security, so we know authentication, authorization, and single sign-on, and all those things are applicable. But not only that, so most of the big enterprises, they have their internal the user base, so you can't get rid of that one. So whatever products you collect or you gather in your architecture, they have to support that. They should be able to work with your existing user stores, such as it can be a LDAP, a JDBC, a simple JDBC user store, can be a NoSQL something, and Active Directory. So those kind of user stores are there. So it should be able to plug those user stores to the products which are handling the authentication and authorization stuff. And those days, like maybe 5 or 10 years ago, people were okay to sign into multiple applications using multiple passwords and multiple accounts. But now that's not the case. The SSO has become kind of norm when they are using multiple applications in your enterprise. So there's no option, you need to have single sign-on. And with the millennials using these applications, social login also has become very important. For example, like if I go to Stack Overflow and like I might not want to create a create an account in Stack Overflow, but I would prefer to log in using either my Google login or if it allows Facebook login. And then to have more fine-grained authorization and authentication, you will have you need this role-based authorization stuff. So these are some of the scenarios. So when we talk about the security part, then we have to incorporate the identity server. So it allows all these the federation stuff, OAuth, SAML. Then if you want fine-grained authorization, it supports SACML. So all the all such things are taken care by the identity server. Now you have the integration sorted out. You are the services and all the integration layer are secured. Now you have the front end, which can be a very cool app, maybe a JSP app, Jaggery. So Jaggery is mostly used in AWS, but some customers use that. So if you want to host your front end, then you can use the application server. And that's an optional part in this architecture, because most of the times it depends on what language you use to develop your front-end application. So if it's applicable, you can use it. And then, so having hosted your application, now it's applicable by, let's say, the web browsers and mobile applications, or using multiple clients, so it's accessible. Now you want to expand it to support ecosystems, because you realize, okay, so I have data, I have exposed them as services, but to reach the wider audience and to reach more people or more entities, you should support this ecosystem stuff. So which means you need to expose your data in a managed way using managed APIs. So you can access control the access to your APIs using these tokens. And also, I told you, the data is the most valuable asset you have, so you can monetize your data. So, so there are some industries which they have very valuable data, and like they haven't even thought about exposing, but if they expose that data, they can make a fortune out of it. So maybe you are representing some of those enterprises. And also, to reach the wider audience and to make it more user friendly, you need to enable your you need to have provide the mobile capability as well, which means then the APIs become more important. So for that, you can use the API manager, and you can control your services through the managed APIs. So you can expose them as APIs, they're managed. You can have these a lot of control over it, and you can know what's happening with your APIs as well. Now, let's say you keep developing multiple applications, multiple internal applications, and so there are like, let's say, first you start with two applications, it becomes 5, 10, 15, and now you have a lot of internal applications, so the enterprise is growing. So you want to manage these internal apps. So for that, this is, again, an optional thing, not a must. So we have the App Manager product. Somewhat similar to the API manager. So the API manager, all your API calls go through the API manager with a token. And in the App Manager, you can host or you can publish your apps to the App Manager, and the internal users, they can come subscribe to these apps, then they can start using it, and the apps will be automatically like they will be SSO'd with the identity server. And so you will just log into the App Manager, and then you can start using the apps. So WSO2, we have an internal deployment of App Manager. So all our internal apps are published to the App Manager. And we, as users, we log into the App Manager, and we access all the apps through that one. For example, our HR applications and the claim management stuff. So everything is going through the App Manager product. So you have the app built, published, now it's been used. Now you want to have some statistics around to know like whether it's behaving as you intended, where you can improve, where you are doing wrong, like how much things you are losing and why you are losing stuff. So for that you need analytics. In the WS3 analytics platform, we have the data analytics server, the complex event processor, and also we have the machine learner, which I haven't listed here because that's somewhat a special case thing, and also the dashboard server. So you can like, so I'll go to the next slide. Where the image in the left-hand side explains the analytics capability. So it can support real-time and real-time analytics, interactive analytics, and the predictive analytics. That predictive analytics is done through the machine learner product and batch analytics. So the CEP can be used for real-time analytics, where you can like take decisions on what's happening at the moment. And now, after you analyze your data or after you run some queries, you have some analyzed data, and then you want to present them in a nice manner. You can use the dashboard server. So Sintuja explained the whole lot of features we have in the dashboard server. And if you guys listen to the talk done by Mr. Roland Major from TFL in the Cloud Stack, he mentioned how they use a dashboard server to create these gadgets for the users to see certain stuff in the London traffic system. So now I was like taking you through how you can build this enterprise app, but I need to talk about like what support we provide as well. So for the development, we provide support using the Developer Studio. So Sanjeev, our CEO, mentioned yesterday in his keynote that we were like a little bit late to start on the development tool, but we have like been able to catch up by now, and we have almost for all the products we have the development support through the Developer Studio. And for the extensions, we have a connector store, for example, for the ESB connectors and the identity server connectors, because we have a lot of extension points. So we have those connectors hosted in the connector store, which you can like download and use in your integration scenario. So that's a screenshot of our connector store, which is publicly available. And then like if you are too busy and if you can't like set things up by your own, you can still use our cloud platform, where we have the App Cloud and API Cloud running at the moment. API Cloud is commercially available, which is the WSO2 API manager as a service. And we have the App Cloud, where you can host your applications. At the moment, you can host PHP applications, Java applications, and very soon we'll have the Node.js stuff. You can host microservices and jQuery applications. And within very few weeks, we'll have the Integration Cloud also. Then you will be able to do cloud-to-cloud integration using our Integration Cloud. For example, you should be able to sync your Salesforce some data in Salesforce to a Google spreadsheet using the ESB connectors and hosting it in the Integration Cloud. And we are planning to work on the Identity Cloud as well, which will be available most probably towards end of this year. Right. So that's it. So I just wanted to explain like how you can leverage the WS2 products on developing an enterprise application and where you can use them. So I think you might you got some understanding on where you can use them and what are their features to some extent. I didn't want to take you through a very a very deep into the instructions, the details. I wanted to touch it in high level.